they're looking forward to Paul and his slide. And as a historical museum, and to our lecture tonight that Paul Cornell is going to give on the 10 most notorious criminal cases in Santa Clara Valley. You are our largest audience, and that's why we had to move it from Civic Hotel over here to the firehouse. We thank you all for coming out on what could be a real rainy evening. We're looking forward to Paul and his slides. A couple of details to take care of before we start. The restrooms are back here. There's coffee and cookies. I'm not sure we're going to have a break though, Paul. No break. You didn't get your coffee and cookies. We'll give you a few minutes between me and Paul to get a cup of coffee if you want one. And then one other thing, there is a charge for the lecture tonight. I know a lot of people came in at the same time. So if you did not pay, throw away in the back, try the coffee pots and the gold colored dress. She has a list of who made reservations. She'll be happy to take your money. Our speaker tonight was so considerate of us that he put together his own little bio for me to read. I've known Paul a really long time. There are parts of this that I didn't know, but parts that I certainly did know. So I picked out the things that I like best. Paul, as you probably know, Paul is a district attorney in Santa Clara County, and he's also the chair of the county's Historical Heritage Commission. He's been active in local preservation efforts. One of the ones that I'm intimately familiar with was his fight to save the Joyce Ranch down, the Burnell Joyce Ranch down in the southern part of NSA. And we thank Paul for those efforts because it'd be happening with the housing development. He's co-founder of the Preservation Action Council in San Jose, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with that organization. They have done absolutely marvelous things in the short years of their existence. They amaze me all the time. Paul is married. He and his wife are expecting their first baby. He's a native of San Jose. He went to St. Christopher's, Bellarmine, and then went south to Loyola Marymount and came back up to Santa Clara for his law degree. Much to know you, he is a product of the Jesuit system. His ancestor Juan Francisco Burnell arrived in San Jose with the Nyanza expedition in 1776 and founded San Francisco, San Jose, Mission Santa Clara, Mission San Jose, and Santa Cruz. One of his ancestors, Jose Burnell, was a frequent visitor of the city jail. The Paul assures us that San Jose, that Jose will not be in tonight's prison. We'd like to welcome Paul Burnell to our lecture series.
At 4:35 p.m. on May 4, 1990, Sherman Hill was driving south on US 101 in the commuter lane, which as you know is reserved for more than one driver, more than one passenger. And the highway patrol officer that was in front of him looked in the rearview mirror and saw there was only one person and a dog in the car behind him. So he got in behind this car, tried to pull it over, but it sped up and took off. And the elderly man, Mr. Hill, did receive a ticket, and he appeared in front of the Santa Clara County Municipal Court. Judge John Pasco was the judge, and the explanation that the man gave was that he was legally blind, could not see, and that the dog was a seeing eye dog, and that Queenie would sit on his lap. And when a car would be coming too close to him, the dog would bark, causing the man to brake. Judge Pasco ruled that the dog did not fall within Vehicle Code Section 21655.5 and cited the man $155 and suspended his driver's license. The reason why I bring this up is twofold. One is, this is a true story, and it is from San Jose. And The first point I'd like to make is that this is what I call notorious. This is the kind of criteria I'm looking for when I choose the 10 most notorious cases. It has to be one that takes notoriety, one that gets newspaper print, and in many cases are internationally known. This case was printed throughout the world, as you can imagine. It showed up in the National Enquirer. I guess that's the true test. But this was the San Francisco Examiner article. And the second reason why I bring up this story is because we're going to take stops along the way. We're going down this little path called history. And as we watch crime and justice go hand in hand down this path, we're going to be looking at some really big, ugly cases, but we're going to take a little stop, take a little break, and look at some of the more interesting and humorous cases that were also notorious. There's more than 10. We're going to go on a little bit. There's a lot of slides, but I guarantee you many things. One is, you'll be entertained tonight. I also promise you, you'll see some slides tonight that have never been seen before, some images of the crime that have never been shown. Also, you will hear some facts about cases which have never been revealed, including where is Giza De Campani today. And you will also be educated because you're going to learn a few terms and a few legal concepts. In January, the trial began. Many women would show up to the jail wall and pass love letters through the window, the bars, brought him food, received autographs, and in fact, a few proposed marriage. Judge Belden was the judge who presided over the trial. David Belden was a very famous judge at the time, and he conducted trials over most of the more important cases of the time, as you'll see. The DA was Thomas Bodley, and the defense attorney was Pleasant Britton Kelly of Kilroy, and Tully wrote his name for him. William Henry Collins, who you'll hear about more later, was the key defense attorney, along with Joseph Addison Moultrie, San Jose. Vasquez was sentenced to hang by the neck until he was dead. The gallows was brought in from Sacramento. These gallows right here are not the gallows that were used to hang Vasquez, because for some reason I can't locate any photographs of the actual hanging, even though it was the most widely attended hanging in California to the day. This is the gallows of a man named Jewell, who was hanged contemporaneously. These gallows were always set up at the southeast corner of Market and St. James Street, which is now the secondary courthouse in downtown San Jose. It's that tall four or five story building. And right there on the corner on the left, you'll see the clerk's office, where you can get a marriage certificate or records. And in the background, you can see the street running along right there is Market Street. This right here is St. James. So with that background, they would build the gallows. The officials would step up, and usually they would have a lot of dignitaries from different areas. In the case of Vasquez, invitations were received by representatives from the Central Pacific Railroad, of course, from Wells Fargo, and in every county throughout California, a law enforcement agency representatives showed up, usually the chief. United States Marshals showed up from Montana, Nevada, Canada, and the East Coast. After a priest from St. Joseph's read in his last rites, the noose was slipped around his neck, and he was hanged. Vasquez was actually left on display for some time before he was removed and brought to this house at Washington near Harrison Street. This photo, by the way, is courtesy of Clyde Arbuckle, who has many wonderful pictures you'll see tonight. After he was dressed up and the funeral took place, he was buried here at the Santa Clara Catholic Cemetery. Vasquez's gravesite, you can see there's a palm tree planted right behind it. There's a predominant space right in the old section if you want to go out and see yourself, just off Winchester. The Garcia Vasquez led a crooked life, and therefore, as you can see, he was buried in a crooked grave. He did not line up with the others, and it was a 45-degree angle. The next case is that of Tommy C. His last name is not in there because he's a minor, or was a minor at the time of the crime, in the late 70s. Deputy DA Lance Baer was the attorney, and Judge Homer Thompson was the judge. Tommy C. wanted to see a house get torn down because he thought that would be great fun. So he called the Employment Development Department, had 100 unemployed wreckers hired. He gave the name of two foremen. Then he called those two construction workers and said, "How'd you like to be a foreman on a great project?" These construction workers, never having been foremen, decided, "Sure, I'll take that opportunity." So when the EDD called the foreman to find out that they actually been contracted to do the job, said, "Yes, we are the foreman." The 100 wreckers showed up, started tearing down the house in San Jose, while Tommy C, parked across the street, was eating his lunch in his car, taking photographs, and enjoying the day. The owner came home to find a pile of rubble where his house used to be. He called the police, and the disgruntled wreckers were on the news that night complaining that they were stiffed out of what they were owed because the EDD failed to pay. And guess who was complaining the loudest in the news broadcast? Tommy C. That's how they got Tommy Singh, and he did go to Juno Hall. The next case you might have heard about it is the case of Emma Hanks versus General Henry Morris Mangley, 1877. This is General Mangley in his early years. He was a brigadier general who fought on the side of Lincoln. That's him in his uniform. He married a woman by the name of Marie Antoinette, and he settled in San Jose, in a place which we now know as the Mangley Park neighborhood. As you can see, this was his estate. This right here is Santa Clara Street. This is 10th Street. And this is William Street. It was a very large area. This river right here is Peggy Creek, which was about where 17th is now, and Arroyo. The entrance was right here. This was a large park which he kept, and he opened it up on Sunday to the city of San Jose. People would come in through this gate and enjoy the day, a sunny day with a picnic. Here's where his house was built, and there are still palm trees from the original track right along this street, which you can see today. This house in the 1870s looked like this. Today, it still stands and looks like this. The wood siding was replaced with plaster, and the inside was subdivided, but basically, it looks predominantly the same. It's at 99 East San Fernando Street, and you see the marker right out front designates it as a city landmark. So who was Henry Morris Mangley? After he finished his military career, which you can ask Jack Douglas, was not quite spectacular, but still he did have his achievements. He, through his political connections, was able to get a job surveying parts of California and Texas. Also through his connections, he was able to open a license for the first commercial bank in California, in San Francisco. I personally believe that he not really had the first commercial bank, but that is credited to him. Others were around that may not have been licensed by the government, but he was early in the commercial banking industry. He was a financier in San Francisco and kept apartments up there, but he lived in San Jose. He was the wealthiest man in Santa Clara Valley. He was worth between $2 to $3 million in 1870 dollars. He produced the Mangleya brand brandy, and he was very well known amongst the well-to-do in California. This is a letter from him to Emily Hanks back at his house, where he wrote from San Francisco saying, "Mr. Ralston," and that is Ralston of the banking fame, "and 40 persons will meet at my house at noon on Wednesday, have the brandy house open, and 4 bottles of my best brandy with ice glasses, etc., in the arbor for them." So he would have 40 of his best friends, senators and the governor, come on down and have a little bit of his brandy. Mangley had a street name for him and also the neighborhood. But there was another street, and that is Julian Street. This is Julian Street at, I believe, 2nd. And this is where Bob Mazzetti has his law offices. Julian Hanks was a realtor, and he also was a trader of Mexican goods. Unfortunately for him, on a trip to Mexico on a ship that he had, went down in a storm, and he lost everything he had, as well as a good part of his fortune which he invested in that journey. He left behind a widow who ran a boarding house on 10th Street for San Jose State students, then called the Normal School, and he had a daughter by the name of Emily Hanks. Emily, at 20 years old, went to support the family by doing chores around the neighborhood for people who had money. And sooner or later, her and the general came to meet him. She must have been beautiful because the general did have discriminating taste, but we do not have a picture of her. We do know that his first wife, actually his only wife, looked like this when she was young, and she died giving birth to the general's second child, a child by the name of Babe. The general eventually had Emily come into her home and darn his socks. No pun intended. This was not Emily, but this is her first cousin, who was an opera singer who married into the Cecil Rhodes family of Rhodesia fame. She did not have this kind of wealth, as you can imagine, by the fact that she had to be darning the socks of her neighbors. But the most interesting thing is, when she showed up on a Sunday afternoon to take that darning job, there were no socks to darn. Eventually, the general did convince her mother to allow Emily to come in as a nanny for the two children, but the neighborhood would talk mostly because they knew what a womanizer the general was. This is an actual soft portrait of General Mabry, demonstrating how he could keep in shape by doing push-ups on the bathtub. I think he just wanted to send a dirty picture to a young lady. In fact, he had that kind of a relationship with Emily. This is a letter that Emily wrote to the general once when she ran away. It says, "Leave me alone when you feel your passions must be satisfied, as that only leads me deeper into sin, and you lose that little respect that you may have left for me. On my part, I satisfy you, because love is there. Not that I think for a moment that it is right in the sight of God and man for us to live as in the past." The general did get into quite a bit of fights. He was violent and he would erupt into anger when he had a fight with Emily. At one point, according to her testimony, throwing her down to the floor of the entryway on a beautiful moonlit night. She did receive a black eye and the door screen was broken. And that was used against him in his court trial. She had taken a position at the San Francisco Mint through her connections to Judge Collins. And Mabry visited her in San Francisco, as did Judge Collins. Mabry tried to reconcile with his dear M and wrote several letters, including this one. "My dear M, come by the Saturday afternoon train and stay over Sunday with us. You will find sights at the depot, and no one will know if you're coming or going. This is the last time I shall invite a friendly reconciliation, and don't deny it." This letter is pretty damaging, as you can tell, because of the line, "No one will know if you're coming or going." And you probably know what this is leading up to. She had a carnal connection with the general, and soon came into a condition. Maybe he had his doctor attempt to induce an abortion by giving her a tincture of ergot, but she threw the mixture into the plant, pretending to drink it, and said, "Ah, that stuff tastes bad." Again, Judge David Belden had the honors of being involved in what was going on in San Jose at the time. He was a very good friend of the general's and a neighbor. Emily sought out Judge Belden's advice, but he had his hands full and felt a conflict of interest. He got her in touch with some attorneys and gave her some advice to marry a doctor who was leaving for the East Coast. And just so Belden was not seen as being a male chauvinist, he did go to General Mabry and did give him a scolding for what he had done. Emily decided to stay in town and demanded that the general marry her. He refused, so she sued Mabry for breach of promise to marry her. This case went to the United States Supreme Court. It was a case of breach of promise to marry, which was a very novel action at the time. It was nationally watched because nobody really knew what the claim meant and how the outcome would be. And we said that she gave up her virtue only upon the promise of marriage in July 1875, and that she said it happened in his bedroom. This is the front cover for the case that went to the Supreme Court, which is in the Bancroft Library, and also Jack Douglas has a copy. This is Mabry's residence in the 1870s, showing the second floor area. General slept here. Emily slept here. Two children slept here. Hank said she'd come in here to pick up his things off the floor, which was her job. And he would die. And for those who are in the neighborhood, it's that one right there. She used all those letters that she had collected and had been found in a book that he kept against him in trial. This says, suppose God called upon us to account for ill-spent life. Could we say we were ready? Oh, no. So what would any good general in this situation do? Accuse the accuser. His defenses were, it was her fault. Two, it was impossible. And three, he blamed somebody else. For those people who are the lawyers in the crowd and have to receive NCLE credits, here's a continuing education question. At a preliminary hearing, if you are being very argumentative and jumping up and down on the head of the witness, and somebody jumps up and says, objection, argumentative, should the judge sustain that objection? Any guesses? The answer is no, because the objection of argumentative only applies when a jury is present and when you're making your argument to the jury, not jumping up and down the head of the witness. That takes care of the education portion of our program. First defense he had was to paint Emily as a gold digger. And second defense he had was to say that it was impossible for her to get pregnant because he practiced the foolproof method of quips and interruptus, which, as everybody knew in 1875, was a slam bang defense. Blame somebody else. And the person that the judge blamed was Judge Collins. Judge Collins lived at the corner of 10th and Santa Clara, which was conveniently close to Nagley's house to say that that's actually where it might have happened. But there was a lot of evidence against Emily. One was that she goes to the La Mole Hotel, which is now called the Aconda Hotel in downtown San Jose, San Pedro and Santa Clara. And there would take the judge as a visitor. Another place that she would go would be the Lick House, which was located at the corner of San Fernando and First, above Carol Palmer's. And the most damaging was that on the night that she said that she got pregnant from the general, she got in a Surrey and traveled down Santa Clara Street, coming to the corner of 3rd with the nursemaid, Ella Salas. Ella Salas gave very damning testimony that when Emily rode here, and I might point out that in 1875, then ladies did not go riding into downtown San Jose, Surrey, she gave over the reins to Ella Salas and told Ella Salas, go up to Miss Fulton's house, the corner of Julian and 3rd, to pick up a dress there. Wait for her, then when you get the dress, come and pick me up. I'm going to walk on down to Judge Collins' house, business, at the corner of 1st and Santa Clara. Ella Salas did go to Miss Fulton's, but Miss Fulton never arrived. Miss Fulton was away on vacation. Emily was over here at Judge Collins' second floor office on a Saturday night at 7 p.m. apparently doing business. After about an hour and a half, Ella got tired of waiting. It was getting dark, so she rode the Surrey over to the business, went up to the second floor, and found them coming out of the second floor office, kind of like buttoning up their clothes. So the jury, in the end, awarded the plaintiff $27,500, which was a lot of money at the time, basically because I think they felt sorry for her. General Nagley appealed the case and won at the appellate court level, which was taken to the Supreme Court and affirmed. So Emily was out of luck. She also disappeared. We don't know what happened to her or her children. What remains of General Nagley is a statue in St. James Park. This is the only statue of a person in San Jose, except for, I believe, Columbus, which is in City Hall. And I think it was a gaming example of San Jose virtue, don't you? That is true. Thank you, Mr. Price. There is also McKinley. This is the only statue of a San Jose resident. The only other statue of a San Jose resident, as you can tell by the discriminating tastes of San Jose residents, was a dentist that used to stand in Plaza Park, but was melted down for work. I'm going to talk about one short preliminary. The shortest preliminary hearing in Santa Clara County history took place not too long ago. For those who are not familiar with preliminary hearing, it is a court hearing in which every felony in the state of California must first be tried in front of a judge to find out if the case is flight-worthy before it is put before a jury. And the second thing you must know is that the district attorney must prove every separate element of the crime. And the third thing you must know is that leading questions are not allowed on direct examination. However, District Attorney Randy Hay decided he could take care of all three of those if he worked out a little deal with the defense attorney. So he arranged ahead of time that he would just ask one question. And this is what the question was. Officer Hamilton, did you see Julio Martinez on the corner of 3rd and Santa Clara Street in the city of San Jose, Santa Clara County, possess and sell 5 grams of cocaine to a purchaser in exchange for money, which cocaine was later retrieved by you and is before you as People's Exhibit 1, that item having been tested for controlled substance, the result of the test being positive for cocaine? The one word answer was yes. No further questions. The defense attorney also had a single question of Officer Hamilton. Officer Hamilton, are you sure? The answer, yes. Further. The judge asked, are there closing arguments? None. Defense attorney, submitted. Judge, I find the allegation, count one, to be sufficiently proved, and I hold Mr. Martinez over to Superior Court for trial. That, my friends, is the day the taxpayers got their money's worth. The next case on our trip is the case of James Dunham, the famous Campbell Axe murderer, 1896. James Dunham was a graduate of San Jose High School and was attending Santa Clara College, studying both Latin and Greek. Even though he was studying Latin and Greek, people that knew him said that he was mentally dull. However, he had a bright personality, and he could get along with just about everybody. He was known to be too stingy to buy booze, was a sloppy dresser, an expert cyclist, and a hard worker. He was 6 foot tall, 31 years old, and had sharp blue eyes. He married a woman named Miss Hattie B. Wells. Hattie lived with her mother, Mrs. A.M. McGlincy, who was widowed and remarried Colonel R.P. McGlincy. McGlincy Lane in the city of Campbell is named for the Colonel, and they all lived there together at their homestead, which is between the Prune Yard and the Winchester Drive-In Theater, if you know where that is. They go up Dry Creek Road to where it dead ends, near the Prune Yard, you jog a little bit to the right and you'll hit McGlincy Lane. It's now predominantly an industrial zone. This is how the ranch looked in 1896. Living here was Minnie Schessler, a servant girl who lived in the main house, George Schabel, a stable hand who lived in the cabin, Robert Briscoe, a farmhand who also lived in the cabin, and a one-year-old infant that was the product of Jim Dunham and his wife. Things started to get a little weird. And Jim started to get into a fight with his father-in-law. And in fact, during a poker game, They became so angry at each other that Jim stopped talking to the Colonel for 6 weeks. Jim became lazy. He was under pressure from his studies, allegedly cramming. In 6 weeks, when it took most people the entire semester to learn. By some accounts, he was on the verge of a divorce, although that is disputed by others. And he was allegedly planning a lawsuit against the Colonel for a work-related injury. This is a picture of the house close up. You can see the size of the man. This is a photo taken in 1955 when the house was demolished. So on Tuesday, May 26, 1896, Jim Dunham came home about 10 p.m. Colonel McClincy and his stepson, James Wells, went to a town meeting. Dunham went upstairs to where his wife and his baby was, and Jim was carrying an axe. He went into the upstairs bedroom, and he put down the axe, gagged, throttled, and jerked the neck of his wife quickly with a snap, breaking her neck. You can see her here lying on the bed. These are her feet. This is her body. She's covered by a blanket. These two are rare photos that were provided by Clyde Arbor. Minnie, the girl who was the maid servant next door, heard the commotion in the next room and had time only to put on her nightgown, buttoning a single button, before she went into the bedroom and received an axe blow to the head. One sharp blow, and then followed by five bashes. All went through to her brain, and you can see her laying on the floor. These are her feet, and she's kind of slipped between the two legs. A note was found on this table that read, "Please say goodbye for me to my dear mother, brother, and stepfather," signed Hattie. It is unknown whether Hattie wrote that note just before she was killed, Jim perhaps giving her a chance to say her goodbyes, or, as is theorized by most people, Jim wrote that note to possibly pretend like it was some kind of suicide, but then this shooting got out of hand and he axed too many blows and he forgot about the note. Then she went downstairs where his mother-in-law was, who was standing in the doorway not knowing what was going on, but then hearing loud crashing and screaming. Mrs. A.M. McClincy received a crash axe to her head, and the autopsy said it was one sharp blow, four blunted blows with the backside of the axe, which crushed her skull. You can see her there laying under the sheet. Jim Dunham went around the house, taking every framed photo of himself, breaking the frame, taking the photo out, rolling them up, and putting them into his pocket, including a large portrait of himself. He did that because, in those days, he knew they would have a hard time tracing him without a photograph. However, he forgot this one. This is a very small photograph. This is the original. And this is taped or glued to the back of a business card. To give you an idea of the size. He got a 45 caliber gun, 38 caliber gun, and ammunition. And sat in the dark and waited for 1 hour for his father-in-law and his brother-in-law to come home. At 11 o'clock at night, the wheels of the carriage were heard to come into the yard. You can see a carriage coming up to the house, drawn by a horse. George, the stable person, came out from the stable, received the horse and carriage, brought it back into the barn area, and then the colonel and his son, his stepson, proceeded to the house. Jim Wells, the brother-in-law of Dunham, came in first, not seeing Jim hiding in the shadows. Dunham let Wells pass by, and then brought the axe down on the colonel. There was a sharp blow to his right eye, and he was felled to the ground. There was a horrific fight between Wells and Dunham inside the house. struggling for the axe. There were gashes in the walls, chips in the fireplace area, and Dunham finally took out both guns and shot Wells point blank, so close to his coat that Jim's coat caught on fire. Wells landed next to the fireplace with 5 bullet holes in it. And as you can see, it was a knocked over chair, it was a china that's been strewn about. And the colonel, who was not dead, crawled through the house and out the kitchen window and was escaping to the cabin. Along this path, the cabin's burning apart. A next door neighbor, L.C. Ross, who Ross Avenue and Ross School is named for, heard the shot, but because he was asleep and in his upstairs bedroom, which is in the farm nearby, he thought it was the ungreased squeaking wheel of the windmill. But then he heard something different. He heard somebody screaming, "Murder! Help! Help! He's killing me!" It was the words of the colonel, who was trying to get into the cabin where the other hired help, Bob Briscoe, was asleep. Bob Briscoe did let the colonel into the cabin, where Jim came upon him and started firing the guns in through the door and actually piercing the colonel on the other side of the door. Jim Dunham then yelled out, "Come out, Mac, come out, I've got to have you." And the colonel said, "I'll come out if you put the guns down." That was a stupid mistake because he fell for it, he came out, and what do you think Jim Dunham did? He shot him down with 2 bullets as he ran from the cabin, landing here. Bob Briscoe was pretty scared. And Jim Dunham was pretty persistent. He went back to the cabin and said, "Come out, Bob, I know you're in there. I saw you in there before, come out." Bob did not want to come out. And what he did was he climbed out the back window of the house, of the shed. But Jim Dunham heard him going through the back window and followed him around to this area, which leads out to the field where the Rosses have their farm. By this time, Ross is coming up towards the house, but at a slow pace, because he's hearing firing of guns. And Bob Briscoe was shot down dead. Then the very persistent Dunham turned to look for George. George, the stable hand, was hiding in the loft and wasn't going to come out. He says, "George, where are you? Where are you?" Couldn't find him, so he figured George must have gone into the city of Canada, which was nearby. So Jim got a horse from the stables and started heading down this road, seeing that there's rows of trees and orchards. This road towards the city of Campbell, and came upon a fellow by the name of Charles Sterrett. Charles Sterrett was coming home from Campbell, on Campbell Avenue, on his way to the Cope Ranch where he lived. Jim said, "Did you see George?" And Charles Sterrett said, "I don't know what you're talking about, I don't know any George. Ida Price, who lived nearby, and who was the namesake of the school, heard the horse riding off, which took Jim Dunham into the darkness." George then came out of the loft to find that everybody was dead. And this incredible photo shows where the two bodies were brought inside. This here is the colonel on a door or a set of boards that they carried him in on, with some slashes to his face. This here is Robert Briscoe, and this is Jim Wells, who fell near the fireplace. This is the axe, which was used to kill the ladies of the house. As you can see, they seem to have rolled up some spare wallpaper. keep the blood from getting on this fine carpet in this well-decorated home. The horse was found near Smith's Creek, but they did not locate Jim Dunham. Smith's Creek is 12 miles this side of Mount Hamilton, high in Paul's Valley. And Jim Dunham was never found. It was the largest manhunt in California history, probably second only to the polyclass search. And polyclass search was heightened only by high-tech technology. The search went on for years, and these sort of posters were even printed down in Mexico. The city of San Jose and the sheriff's office of Santa Clara County received untold numbers of telegrams, people who said they caught Jim Dunham, and it was all to no avail because it never was Jim Dunham. Here, Ms. Mary Zimmerman of San Francisco, formerly of San Jose, identified Dunham positively, fixed the reward, but it was not Jim Dunham. Here is a poor fellow named Hatfield. He was arrested dozens of times because he looked just like Jim Dunham. And this photograph was actually a police photograph, and they took pictures of him and then send it into the city of San Jose and Campbell and say, is this done? And there are just a slew of photographs of poor Hatfield, because everywhere he went, people would cuff him and send him his photo. But under the severest of beatings, Hatfield could not speak a word of German, or Greek, or Latin, so they knew it was not the right thing. What do you think? Jim Dunham's brother, Charles Dunham, worked down on First Street in San Jose. And he thought that his brother must have just went insane because he had just spent a Sunday dinner the week before with the whole family out there from the Flimsy farm. And he did not notice any kind of strain or stress and thought everything was hunky dory. And I'm not sure if it's a brother just trying to cover up for his brother or maybe after somebody's dead and the killer escapes, everybody makes up stories about how there wasn't any witness. We're not sure. Minnie Schlesler, the girl who was on the second floor who was killed, was sent back to her family on the East Coast, her dead body. And the rest of the family who were related were all buried out at Oak Hill Cemetery. Here's Jim Dunham's wife, Hattie. Next door is Mrs. Ada McClancy, Jim's mother-in-law. Right next to her is the colonel's grave. This is James Wells, his brother-in-law. And this is Robert Briscoe, the farmhand who lived out in the ship. And I think the most interesting thing, if you go see this for yourself, is at the bottom of the tombstones is written, "Vengeance is mine. I will repay." Pardon me?
What happened to the baby?
We do not know. It is said that the only reason why Jim Dunham let the baby live instead of killing it was so that it could inherit the McGlincy fortune and that he would come back someday to maybe take over. But it is not known. It was given to an aunt to take care of for a short time, and I don't know whatever happened to the baby. The next case is that of Bertha Baronga, which, as you know from the record news, does not make my top 10 list, but I threw it in here just so you can see another photo of her. In 1907, Bertha Baronga and her husband, fire captain Narciso Frank Baronga, went to see a flick at the Jose Theater in downtown San Jose. When they returned home, Ms. Baronga cut off her husband's penis with a straight-edge razor because she thought he was about to go to Mexico and leave her a scorned woman. She escaped, or tried to escape, by dressing up like a man in man's clothing and riding a bike out of town, but she was gone. And Frank, this was before microsurgery, left San Jose and retired at an early age to his family rancho in Monterey County, known as Rancho Paloma. Bertha got 5 years in prison, and the penis was in the courthouse basement for several years, and was reportedly thrown out during a spring cleaning by court clerk John Carroll, now an attorney. Now we're going to learn a term we all should know. When a man has his penis cut off by his wife or anybody, what is that called? It is not castration, because castration is when your testicles are removed. It's actually a penisectomy. Now you'll have something to go home and tell the rest of your family. The next case is that of the heart kidnapping. We did not actually go to trial, but before we touch upon this story, which I'm sure you're all familiar, I have a case called the case of Arthur Scotland, which shows that there are two means of the word disposition. The defense attorney filed a really dumb motion in court, and before making his final argument, the attorney wanted to get a feel for how the judge was going to rule or dispose of the motion. So the defense asked the judge, "Your Honor, I believe that I would ask first that the court indicate what its disposition is towards ruling on the demurrer." The judge said, "What my disposition is? You want the disposition now? My disposition then is upset." There was a little story I got in Judge List's department last week. The heart kidnapping in 1933 was probably the most notorious as far as world coverage. It was among the top 10 stories of that year internationally. I'm going to go through this fairly quickly because I think everybody here knows of it, but if you've never heard of the case, you can still learn quite a bit from just this slideshow. If you'd like to read the book, Swift Justice by Harry Thurlow, this is a very detailed and interesting account. Brooke Hart, known to his friends as Brookie, was a Santa Clara College student who was from a very well-to-do family. And they lived on this tree line, the Alameda, in this mansion. Brookie was heir to the Hearts Department Store. This is their warehouse number 2, which still stands. If you look just off the Guadalupe Parkway as you come into downtown San Jose, look off to your right, down by the railroad tracks. Brooke took a job as assistant manager of the store, which was located on the southeast corner of Market and Santa Clara Street, where the Sumitomo Bank is today, and he was going to open it one day. His grandfather, Leopold Hart, started across the street where the San Jose National Bank is today. In 1856, he bought a little store and built it into an empire. And on November 9th, 1993, Harold Thurman and John Holmes decided to kidnap the young Hart for ransom. This is Harold Thurman, who was from a well-respected San Jose family. He'd never been in trouble with the law. But the mastermind of the case was John Holmes, also from a middle-class, well-respected San Jose family. Everybody was pretty shocked that these two ended up being the ones who kidnapped Brookie. Both needed money, and so they chose to kidnap one of the wealthier families in town. They went to a parking lot, which used to be located down this street where a Lyston Alley had a parking lot where employees of the Hart department store would go to. And at closing time, they did kidnap Brookie Hart. They took the body up to San Mateo Bridge, where they crushed the skull with concrete, tied his feet with wire, bound him to cement blocks. And in case that wouldn't do the job, they taped him up, stabbed him, shot him, and tried to drown him by throwing him out into the water. Brooke Hart did not die immediately and screamed for mom. And apparently you can still see these scrape marks in his fingernails on one of the wood posts that used to hold up San Mateo Bridge. His body was found sometime later by this duck hunter, Leonard Dolph. Thurman and Holmes were already in custody because they were not very smart kidnappers. This is the location of what used to be Plaza Garage. It was located sort of behind this area. And if you're in Plaza Park, downtown San Jose, this is the Chamber of Commerce building. The Fairmont Hotel would be down here. And this is a retirement home, which is a large apartment structure. And this is the Union. This is the place where Thurman decided to make his phone call for ransom at one point along his series of phone calls. And believe it or not, this was directly across the street from the police station, which at that time was located in the center of Plaza Park. So the phone call was traced to that location, and they caught him as he was hanging up on the phone. He confessed to the crime and led police to Holmes. John Holmes, the mastermind, when they brought Thurman up to his apartment on the second floor, and the police knocked on the door, and the police said, "You might as well give yourself up." Thurman confessed everything. John Holmes said, "The hell you did." And they were both arrested at the jail, which at that time was located between what is now the main downtown post office, which was under construction at the time, and the old courthouse, which both faced St. James Park. A large pipe was taken from that construction site of the post office, and on Sunday evening, November 26th, 1993, they used that pipe to batter down the door of the jail. I have been told by people who were present that the way they got everybody involved in such a caper was first because of the riot mentality. We heard about in the Los Angeles riot. And secondly, because they go to hold a barge in downtown San Jose and say, "We're going to have a necktie party out at St. James Park." So most of the people there, or a good number of them, were probably under the influence, had a few cocktails. Thurman, you see here in the center, with Sheriff Bill Emig to his left, and FBI agent Vitale to his right, was taken out and hanged just in front of the courthouse, about at this location. The tree no longer stands. It was chipped up into little pieces for souvenirs. Holmes, seen here, was hanged nearby in another tree. And as you see, they were stripped down both for humiliation and for souvenirs. And the John B. Young, San Jose Mercury reporter at the time, wrote what I thought was a very interesting statement. "I saw a prominent attorney, an officer of the Court of Justice, on crutches, struggling to get a place on the ropes. I also know that there were a judge and several deputy sheriffs who watched from the third story windows of the old courthouse as the spectacle took place." This is the location where Holmes was home. That tree also was home. This is a souvenir postcard from the time. It's actually kind of a trick photography deal because they weren't hung near each other. But if you look closely, you can see where there was a line along this tree, which divides the two pictures, and they were spliced together. Governor Sonny Ross was very happy about this event, and he made comments such as, "Nobody from the fine city of San Jose will be prosecuted for this hanging, and if only all the people in California were like those citizens of San Jose, we would have a great start." There was a lack of corruption in California, and San Jose also holds claim to the last mob lynching of a Mexican in all of California, which took place in 1877 when two bandidos confessed to murder and robbery, were snatched from jail, and hung from the bridge over the Guadalupe. There was no trial in this case, obviously. The Court of Historical Inquiry, which was sponsored by the Bench and Bar Historical Society, did retry the case as if it had occurred, using all the evidence from the day, and Judge John Flaherty presided. And I think the most interesting thing of that retrial was that the defense put forth by Holmes was that he wasn't there at the time of the killing because he was in the theater with his family watching the Three Little Pigs, the number one movie of that year. And speaking of Judge John Flaherty, there's the case of Anthony Broussard, 1983. There are no photos that I have of this case, and it is a very quick mention. If you've ever seen the movie River's Edge, this is what the story is based on. It's a true story in which a black juvenile named Anthony Broussard, who was quite large, about 6'3", 240 pounds, was asking a white girl in his school to be his girlfriend. She said no. So he abducted her, raped her, strangled her, and buried her under a pile of leaves in the Calaveras Reservoir in Milpitas. Anthony Broussard took several kids from Samuel Ayers School in Milpitas High to see the body, and they told two friends, and so on, to the point where everybody in school practically had gone up to see this poor dead girl. No one ever reported this to the police or told anybody, school teachers, family, counselors. The one kid who finally snitched had to leave the state with his family because of the harassment he received. The next case is out of David Lampson, 1933. This is a biggie. This is the great Stanford murder. David Lampson, a 30-year-old advertising manager at the Stanford University Press, lived on this beautiful tree-lined street, actually on the campus of Stanford University. The house was located at 622 Salvatierra Street, and this is where he lived. He lived there with his wife and his two-year-old daughter, Genevieve Aline. On the early morning of May 30th, 1933, which was Memorial Day, he went into his backyard very early and did some gardening. At about 8 o'clock, he went back into the house, prepared a breakfast tray for his wife, drew the bath, and carried his wife into the bath. We don't really know why he carried her into the bathroom or bathtub, and he never gave an explanation for that. He then went back outside to chat with his neighbor over this fence here and continued with his gardening. Lampson, who was quite well-educated and knowledgeable at the time, began to burn some brush in his backyard. He piled up twigs and brush together and set a little fire. He took off his shirt because it was a very warm morning. And at about 10 o'clock, some renters came around to the front of the house. They were going to rent for the summer while he and his wife and his child were on vacation. He heard the doorbell and went around the front side of the house to the front door to greet these people who he knew. And he was bare-chested, so he went back into the house to get a shirt. A scream was heard throughout the house coming from this window, which is the bathroom window on the side of the house. The scream was caused by this sight. This is the dead body of his wife draped over the bathtub. He ran back out into the front yard screaming, "My wife's been murdered!" No explanation was given for the fact that he used the word murder, and the prosecution used that to their advantage. Also, Lampson fainted. However, the district attorney's office pointed out that he was an actor in college and was involved in amateur productions. Dr. Lampson, his sister who lived nearby, came over, and Deputy John Moore overheard a conversation between the two in which Lampson is alleged to have said, "My God, why did I marry her?" Neighbor Mrs. Brown came over, and being the good Mrs. Brown neighbor that she was, mopped up the blood on the walls, before, much to dismay of the coroners and the police. Lampson was arrested where he took a ride into San Jose with Deputy Buffington on the left, and the Buffington House on Lincoln Avenue still stands, and Sheriff Bill Emmett, who you've seen earlier, on his right. This is an amazing photo from the actual court proceedings. And the newspaper articles at the time said that 1,000 people tried to get inside this trial that started on August 17, 1933. Two defense attorneys were hired to defend him, and they had two different theories. One defense attorney's theory was that a stranger must have come along and bashed out her brains. The other is that she must have slipped and fell. Defense attorney Edwin M. Rhea won the argument, and the other attorney was fired. Judge Robin Sayer presided. Deputy District Attorney Pete Lindsay was the DA. And defense attorney Edwin McKenzie of Stanford fame did some of the appellate. There's a lot of compelling evidence in this case. The fracture to the head indicated that there were four separate and distinct blows, which are not in line with somebody who slipped in a bathtub to get their head in the faucet. Mm-hmm. Also, the blood splatters shown, this is a blood splatter projectile device, which shows the degree of splatter and length of splatter, that sort of thing. There was blood found on the store, you see a couple of them here, and there was blood found on the ceiling, on the windows, on the walls, everywhere, which was not in line with somebody who was still before. Also, in the backyard, around this area right here, where it was burning brush, although this has obviously been re-landscaped quite well, I should add, there was found a 10-inch steel pipe underneath the ashes of the brush that he was burning that day. And that 10-inch steel pipe matched the indentation on the back of the head of Mrs. Lampson. There was red paint that was on this patio, which they first believed to be blood, to indicate that he would have gone back and forth tracking blood. And the fact that his shirt was removed, and that shirt was never produced by the defense, put great weight towards the evidence that he, in fact, was the killer. The motive that was put forth was that he wanted to get rid of his wife because he was having an affair. Frank Taylor, a co-worker, no relation to Frank Taylor of San Jose, a co-worker testified that Lampson said, "I can't go on like this," referring to his troubled marriage. He had an affair with a Mrs. Sarah Kelly of Sacramento, and his love letters, flowers, receipts, and his rendezvous were documented. The maid who lived at the house, Clara Malowitz, said that there was fighting between the husband and wife. However, Mary Dolores Roberts, who was the nursemaid to the two-year-old Genevieve, said there was never any discord or cheers. Lampson admitted that the night before the death, he slept in the maid's room, not his own, but never gave an explanation. The defense theory was that this bathroom was way too small for somebody to be swinging a pipe around in there. Here you can see the window, which is shown in the earlier photograph, the backyard, and this area. Here's the tub where she was found. Here's the door where the splatter projectile device was affixed. And this would have been the bedroom where you could look in. Also, the defense argued that the murder weapon was in a bonfire that would be sure to be found, so why would he leave the weapon right there in his own backyard? This is a very interesting photograph. It was actually part of the defense. They tried to reenact different ways she could have bashed out her brains and said, "Beat the tub." I don't know if this was very convincing because the blow was to the back of the head. But this is a little better. This is Dr. E. Heinrich, who was hired by the feds to lay out some kind of explanation. And I think that woman is perhaps his wife. Perhaps a photographer's assistant. I don't know. But the best part about Dr. E.O. Heinrich was on cross-examination, the prosecution found out that this doctor examined the pipe, and in his opinion, there was blood on the pipe. So they should have left this doctor at home. Lamson avoided the press, and there was, however, a huge following of his, well-educated, highbrow people who published a booklet on his innocence. It was a pretty convincing booklet. Willis Peck has a copy if you'd like to read it. Jurors were taken on picnics to Alum Rock Park and taken to movies because the trial lasted so long and because they had to keep them away from the public because of the notoriety. I don't think they take people on picnics to Alum Rock Park. They don't even keep me in hotel rooms anymore. Lamson was found guilty of first-degree murder. And this is a rare photograph of him on death row. As you can see, the date of execution is December 15th. This photo was taken on October 6th. This is the face of a man who's facing his death. While he was on death row, he wrote a book called We Were About to Die. We should get a public record. Lucky for our friend Lamson, in the short span between October 6th and December 15th, the Supreme Court overturned the conviction and remanded the case to Santa Clara County for retrial based upon the fact that the blood on the pipe was pure conjecture. It was unlikely that a blow could have caused the injuries, and it could have been an accidental fall. So there were two theories, and the jury should have been instructed as such. He was retried three times. In 1936, the fourth case was set, but not before Lamson had to sit in prison quite a long time. His second trial, interestingly, a juror slipped in a tub in the hotel and was seriously injured. So that was a mistrial. I'm not sure. I think if I was the defense, I'd like that. If I think I was the prosecution, I'd like that, because you can argue it both ways. Because that juror did not die on that slip. The third trial, 200 names disappeared from the jury selection list, so that, of course, was a mistrial. And the fourth trial was a hung jury. 3 years later, less 1 month, had passed since the death of his wife. And when it was set for the fifth time, they actually showed it to trial, and then the district attorney decided to dismiss the case. David Lamson fainted dead away, and he was released. This is a picture in the local paper showing him walking into, I guess, the sunrise or sunset, I'm not sure which. Probably the sunrise in this case. And you can see he's a little bit older. There will be a retrial of this case by the Court of Historical Inquiry on Thursday, May 24th at 7:30. It's going to be a battle between Santa Clara University and Stanford. And Stanford, of course, defending their David Lamson.
March 24th.
Is it? Thank you. The next case is John Thomas Draper. Does anybody know who John Thomas Draper is? Who said that? That's correct. Jeff Alexander wins the door prize at his Kempton Crunch. In 1972, Silicon Valley's most notorious phone freak, spelled P-H-R-E-A-K, and cult hero of the 60s was known as Captain Crunch. He was tried in federal court because he discovered that a toy whistle that you get in the bottom of the Captain Crunch box was the same frequency that the telephone company used, and he made free phone calls all around the world. He also was one of the designers of the Blue Box. And those who know Steve Wozniak, Steve Wozniak worked on the Blue Box as well. It was an illegal device that was used to make free phone calls and was not traceable. Captain Crunch also invented, in his spare time, the automatic speed read dial, which was not used until 20 years later, but he did have it. It was part of this Blue Box that he created. The FBI could not catch him until March 27, 1972, where he was arrested in his gadgets. Judge Peckham let him go with a warning, but he was caught 4 years later, making a business out of ripping off Pat Bell, and he was sent to prison for 4 years. He was caught again in a big network scam based out of Philadelphia, and he was brought back to San Jose, where Peckham said to him, "Is this not simple? You have to pay for your telephone calls." And sent him to the federal penitentiary, where Draper was all the happier because he wrote a software program called Easy Writer, which made him a fortune from prison. Thomas Talley, 1953. Thomas Talley was a cattle baron from New Mexico who inherited a great fortune and decided that he would spend his life gambling and having a good time. While in a Denver hotel, he met Miss Marge Edwards, who was married at that time to Mr. Edwards. And Talley was married as well. She was a cashier. He fell in love, or so he says. They both divorced each other's spouses and were married in 1945. This is a kind of an interesting wedding photo. It shows his personality. They first lived in New Mexico, but then moved to the hills of Los Gatos, to this place, which is at the corner of Panorama Drive, called Camino Grande, in Montecito. It was described at the time as a $75,000 palatial ranch house with a swimming pool. And it's, some of its details have been refixed and repainted. It pretty much looked like that in 1950. Marge and Tom Talley fought a lot. They were notorious fighters. Both went to the hospital several times. One time she showed up and the doctor said her breast looked like raw liver. She even suffered a broken back. His drinking led him to a sanitarium, and on December 23rd, 1949, he got drunk and shot his wife, and she ran from the house, landing right there on the doorstep. Talley went down to Falashi's bar in Los Gatos and said three things at the bar stool: "Merry Christmas, give me a drink, I've got a dead wife up at the house." And I love that face. Jim Ricardo was his first attorney, so he tried to contact him but could not. So he called his best friend, an accountant and salesman, Wiley Van Heck, who lived in downtown San Jose. Van Heck drove up to Falashi's bar, and they did hail James Ricardo. And Jim Ricardo got into his pants and coat and drove out to the bar, where they then went up to the house. Ricardo was called at 9:23. However, Ricardo did not call the police until 10:53, more than an hour later. Here's a picture of Jim Ricardo in his early days of practicing law. And the trial was presided by Honorable William James, and Mr. Ricardo was wise enough to bring in George T. Davis, because at that time, Mr. Ricardo had not had great experience in death cases, whereas George T. Davis was the hired gun for murder cases in California at the time. The district attorney at the time was Nat Menard, shown here on the right, and him and Ricardo were at odds from the beginning. Ricardo, seen here on the far left, And I think it's interesting, back in the 50s, it looks like they took publicity shots. Everybody all together, nice and cozy. But these two gentlemen, on either ends of this photo, could not stand to be in the same room with each other. In fact, Menard did not like Jim Picardo's opening statement, so Menard started out with both guns blazing. He said, and this is a famous quote which got him in part in trouble, "There have been a number of statements made by Mr. Picardo concerning the advantage to you, the jury, that is gained by the prosecution because the defendant is not permitted to present its defense until after the prosecution has completed the case. In order to share the advantage, if it is thought to be such, at this time, we wish to call as our witness the defendant, Thomas P. Talley." All hell broke loose, and after consultation, Talley refused to take the stand. The lawyers in the crowd, at this time, it was not really considered a mistrial to call the defense witness, but you weren't supposed to do it as your key witness straight off the bat. And this led to the hallmark case of People versus Griffin, which is, you might have been supposed to mention today, that the defendant is not taking the stand, or has the right to take the stand, or even hint at anything about the defendant, because it is deemed prejudicial. Also during the trial, it was learned by the prosecution, a few minutes before Wiley Van Heck took the stand, that Thomas Talley told Wiley, while they were in the car, waiting for Jim Picardo to arrive, "She's got an awful big hole in her, and a 45 makes a big hole." Interestingly, a 45 is exactly the kind of slug that was found inside of her chest. And that was good evidence that he knew the murder weapon and in fact held it. Furthermore, there was O-type blood on his expensive gabardine trousers. He did not have O-type blood, she did. Mrs. Alta Shoemaker was a key witness that Menard, Deputy District Attorney Menard, found in New Mexico. She said that Talley had told her, before going to California, that he wanted somebody for $500 to kill his wife. And then he thought, "I got a cheaper way, I'll do it myself and make it look like a burglary. Furthermore, I'll move to California where she'll have no friends." He later called another witness in New Mexico and said, "Why do you think I moved to New Mexico? Why do you think I moved out of New Mexico? This way, she would have no way, she'd have no ties with any friends, and I wanted to go where the best attorney in the United States is, Jim Picardo." Jim Picardo loved that statement, which came out in trial. He took on that moniker and has been wearing it ever since. Mrs. Alta Shoemaker gave a beautiful statement to the press in New Mexico, which was, "I will put this information before the authorities if I have to crawl to California on my hands and knees." She didn't have to crawl on her hands and knees. Lou Bergman arranged for an airplane. Menard also made Talley write on a chalkboard in front of the jury, "Nothing is to be concealed from the jury. That goes from my attorney too. Signed, Thomas Talley." The defense was that Talley was legally incapable of an act of murder because he was drunk and was taking cold medicine which contained belladonna, and he was suffering from a 4-day blackout. The jury did not buy it. He was found guilty, and he said to the press immediately after the verdict, "I felt like I'd been kicked by a couple of steers." Picardo appealed the case, and Menard filed a brief with the District Court of Appeals, stating that Jim Picardo was an accessory to the murder because he helped allegedly wipe the fingerprints from the murder weapon, which was in a holster of the bedpost, during the hour in which he and Talley were there before they called the police. The verdict was overturned 2 years later because Menard had used a diary of Marge that highlighted some very serious fights and her fear that she was going to be killed just before she was in fact killed, because there was the right to confrontation, and he was denied that. That was one of the basis for the reversal. Also, minority made closing statements, which they thought were inflammatory, such as Thomas Talley being the only one to tell you the truth. God knows he's not going to take that stand. He can tell you anything other than he suffered from a black. And he made comments such as, God knows Thomas Talley is guilty. And anyone hiring San Francisco attorney George T. Davis and Jim Ricardo must be guilty. Interesting side note, Marge's $10,000 wedding ring disappeared during the trial. But Ricardo blamed Menard. Menard blamed Ricardo. The case was retried. He was found guilty of second-degree murder. He was sentenced to 10 years. He served 5.5. And in 1956, Talley was released, married his best friend's wife, and moved to San Diego, where he still lives today. He is still alive. Sorolo is the next case. And Dean Jerry Coleman coined the phrase Dante's Garden. In 1982, Dante Sorolo lived at 2085 Clark Avenue in the city of Santa Clara. This is off El Camino between the Civic Center and Mariani's Restaurant near Bowers Avenue. Sorolo was growing pot in his backyard. This is the house, but you can see there's been an addition, second half. In that area where the second half addition was, there was marijuana, as well as in that side yard, which is close to us. In September 1982, neighbor Bob McDermott, who I met and snapped a photo of here, got tired of the dope being grown in his neighbor's yard and called the police. Two reserve officers also lived right next door, and so the house was under suspicion. The police, however, could not see over the fence because Dante had built a double fence, including bamboo, which went up pretty high. So the police of Santa Clara rented an airplane, flew over the top, and took pictures from high. They're about 1,000 feet up, and they used a regular 35mm camera, and they did capture 73 marijuana plants on film. First thing they did, in the defense, when the prosecution tried to put Dante in jail, was say that there was never a search warrant, and that flight was a search. Here's the backyard. You can see that Dante's got lots of privacy. He's got about six of these little rent-a-shims in his yard. I don't know what's in that. The motion to suppress was heard before Judge Merlin Pesterino Zucker, and she said there was no search, therefore there was no need for a warrant. The U.S. Supreme Court ruled that Zucker was right, stating that Dante had no reasonable expectation of privacy because anybody flying over in an airplane can look into anybody's backyard. That's still the law. And I think Dante has grandchildren. Gentlemen, this is a quick stop on our tour. This is Joseph Bonanno Sr. In 1980, he, along with his family, William Joseph Bonanno, who lived in San Jose, were brought before a federal court. I think this was the gang that could not shoot straight. Defense attorney Albert J. Krieger, who's back there with a bald head, he's seen in the news from time to time. At that time, his fee was $10,000 per hour, and he represents the mafia. The U.S. Strike Force prosecutor was Michael Sterick, and the judge was William Engelmann. It was a very convoluted path to get him to trial. But basically, they could not prove all the killings that were taking place down in San Diego. So they decided to get him the way they got Al Capone, which was through money. They proved that the Bonannos were laundering money through Kachina Fashions, which was in Las Gatas, U.S. Mattress and Furniture, which was in Campbell. And I'm sure you've all shopped at the Cat House Boutique in Las Gatas, and another outfit, a cat house boutique in Aptos. Bonanno tried to fight this unsuccessfully. At 78 years old, he was incarcerated. He wrote a book along with prison called A Man of Honor. And he said in that book, he wanted to be the boss of all bosses and was the founding father of the modern American mafia. He was also brought to court on charges of witness persuading. His nephew, Jack DeFilippi of San Jose, prepared all the witnesses in the Bonanno family to testify in a certain way at Joe Bonanno Sr.'s direction. The best part about this case is the fact that FBI agents dressed up to be garbage collectors, collected his garbage for about 3 years, pulling about every little scrap of paper until they finally hit a jackpot with the kind of information they wanted. And the case law still stands today that if you throw something in your garbage can, you've lost your privacy interest in that garbage. Judge Ingram ruled that one who puts his secrets in his trash can do so only at his own peril. FBI agents from California and Arizona filed in to listen to the sentencing of this man. He got maximum 5 years and $10,000. Dr. Giza De Caplani is the case of 1962, which I think is the most interesting of all the cases. Count Giza, whose name used to be Caplani, was actually a nobleman and a doctor living in Hungary. He defected to avoid the communist persecution, and while in England as a refugee, he wrote a book called Doctor in Revolt. And it was fairly revolting because it was a fictitious portrayal of a hero, and he really had nothing to do with the 1956 uprising in his home. He claimed in that book that his heroism cost him his sight in one eye. But that was a bald-faced lie because he lost the sight of his eye when he was a teenager. And this is the face of a psycho killer. He came to America and changed his name to Dave Caplani. He thought that Dave would make him sound more royal. And he took a job first at Harvard University, earning a specialty in anesthetics in his spare time. And then he took a teaching post at Yale. When he turned 36, he moved to San Francisco, where he dated just about every woman in San Francisco General Hospital. He met a woman named Hanna Pilar, her name is spelled H-A-J-N-A. She was a 25-year-old model, showgirl, and socialite. By all accounts, she was very beautiful. She had lavender violet eyes, and she had the purest white skin. She was the daughter of a famous Hungarian fencer, Colonel Georgi Pilar, who was a fencing coach in Hungary during the 1956 Olympics, was their prize fencer, and was the coach of that team. He too defected from Hungary during the Olympic Games in Australia and moved to San Francisco, dying shortly after his arrival. Hannah's mother decided that the count would be a terrific find for the daughter, would give their family high standing and encourage the marriage. Giza married Hannah for her beauty. It made all the social columns, and they went off to Hawaii, where Giza learned that Hannah was not very interested in him sexually. The good doctor returned to San Jose a very unhappy man, and he took a job at San Jose Doctors Hospital, and they moved into the apartment complex known as the Plantation Apartments, which is on 1125 Ranchero Way in San Jose. This is just off Highway 280, at Saratoga Avenue. It was a big cluster of apartment complexes. 2 weeks after moving into this complex, he hears that she is seeing someone else, but it is only a rumor. The apartment complex was brand new in its time, and all the doctors and accountants, people with high-paying jobs, lived here. on August 28, 1962. He stopped by at Woolworth on the way home from work, got duct tape and electrical cord, put it in a briefcase. Then he went to the hospital and picked up three pint bottles of acid, nitric, hydrochloric, and sulfuric. Also gone out to etch steel and burn holes through floors. He also threw in, for good measure, some gloves, gauze, and forceps. This is the swimming pool area of their complex. And on that hot August night, he went home, passing his pool, and after work, his wife came home, came through this area, and up into their apartment, where she decided she wanted to make love. He attempted to, but he could not perform the two times he did. This is a diagram showing their bedroom. This was a court exhibit. Here is the bed they were on. This is a dresser where there was music, radio. And here is a phonograph, and that phonograph stand. He got very upset about the fact that he could not perform, and he leapt up, turned the music on loud, opened up his torture kit briefcase, beat his wife's nude body, taped and gagged her, took out a butcher knife, and slashed her. And then he wrote this note and put it in front of her face. Does anybody here speak Hungarian? Because I don't know what the hell it says. No, what this really says is, do not shout, do what I tell you, or else you will die. The radio was blaring, covered in muffled monotone wails coming from Hannah's throat. The good doctor went down these stairs and opened up the screen door of apartment 9, which is just below his apartment 30. And to the surprise of the two women who lived downstairs, who thought it strange that he just opened up their screen door without permission, popped his head in and said, "The music isn't too loud, is it?" And they said, "No." So he walked back upstairs and put on the second radio, blaring classical music. The first thing he did was he excised her nipples with the scalpel. He dripped acid through her eyes, which eventually went through to her skull. He burned away her genitals by dabbing the acid on a swab and then putting it with his gloves and forceps onto her genital area. And she received third-degree burns over 60% of her body. Her hair turned three colors, white, green, and orange from the acid. Interestingly, Giza received no burns during his surgically controlled application of acid-soaked gauze. After about 2.5 hours, the wailing became very loud. It became so loud, neighbors were wondering what the heck was going on with an apartment 30. This here is the bedroom window. This is the bathroom. The doctor himself called the police. When they arrived, he said that he was just trying to take away her beauty and that she would not die. Of course, there was enough acid to knock a 5-foot circular hole in the carpet at the foot of the bed where she lay. Giza was arrested, and his wife was taken to Valley Medical Center. She was then transferred to San Francisco, where she died 33 days later after an unbelievable amount of suffering. The doctor said, there's a team of about 10 doctors, free of charge. The doctor said in her testimony that she no longer had eyelids and that her skin was that over-tanned leather. It was too difficult for her to go to the bathroom. It was too difficult for her to have any kind of catheter because of the way that she had burned away her midsection. It went to trial, and Judge Raymond Callahan was the judge. Lou Berger was the judge. John Schatz were the DAs. John Shox was a former FBI agent, then the DA, then a district attorney, and then later became a judge. Defense Attorney Paul McCloskey of Palo Alto was fired just before the trial began, and Defense Attorney Greg DeVilbus was hired. He'd only been 2 years out of Santa Clara University, but by all accounts, he was a very talented attorney. The first defense was that he had suppressed homosexual tendencies and was out of control. And the second defense was that he had an Oedipal complex. He remained in court calm and collected, quite the gentleman all the time, except for on two occasions. One, when the defense attorney was talking about his Oedipal complex and they had to start talking about his mother, he jumped out of his chair, screamed, "Don't talk about my mother that way." And the second time, when he was shown, and the whole jury was shown, a photo of Hannah's decomposed face, which is too hideous to show here tonight, he jumped up out of the chair and yelled, "What did you do to her?" And the cop was not this way. This was being pulled back to his chair. The third defense was that he was a paranoid schizophrenic. The reason why he yelled, "What did you do to her?" was because Giza had a split personality. He was not only Dr. Giza de Capani, but he was Pierre de la Roche. Yes, it is true. That name means Peter the Rock, an aggressive French journalist who he says first came out of him when he was standing before the Mona Lisa, the real Mona Lisa, and a woman came up to him, tapped him on the shoulder, and said, "Pierre," to which he replied, "Oui." Thus began the incredible story of Pierre de la Roche. He did testify later that he wanted to beat her up like a dirty slut, meaning the girl that tapped him on the shoulder, not Mona Lisa. But at any rate, he did have this aggressive side to him. Pierre also allegedly impregnated a girl named Ruth Kroger when he was in the hospital in Minnesota, and Giza was paying the support for that woman. But that woman was brought in by the prosecution who located her in Germany, in a little town, brought her in, and she said, "He never mentioned anything about Pierre Roche. I always knew he was Giza de Capani," which chipped away at his story. Pierre went to a podiatrist 2 times to have his feet looked at, and 2 podiatrists testified, "This man who you see before us is the man who showed up to have his feet looked at." In his medical office, he had 3 pictures. The one in the middle was his mother, the one on the left was a photo of himself, the one on the right was a photo of him as Pierre de la Roche. Kind of a nut. The jury and the press believed him and felt sorry for him until Lou Bergma put on a terrific cross-examination of the psychiatrist, and it was discovered that somebody suffering from multiple personality syndrome does not know the identity of the other personality. Therefore, there's no way Giza de Capani would have known the name, identity, or actions of Pierre de Roche. And that caused him to trial. He was found guilty of murder after being found sane. This case was followed internationally. David Nave, court clerk in Department 39, whom I work with, said that the Russian embassy in Washington, D.C. got nightly transcripts of this case. It was also locally followed and well known. When I was at the apartment complex, I talked to Nellie Hudson, who was the manager just after this event, and she said they could not rent out apartment number 30 because it was known to the people who would come to the house, to the apartment, as Acid Wing. She also begged me not to tell the people in apartment 30 why I was there. Devil Bliss later worked for a special legal clinic for Haiti Days on Second Street. He died 2 years ago of cancer and had a quite a good defense career. Victor Buddy served less than 14 years and was paroled to Taiwan to be a medical missionary for life. That was his parole. Once there, he threatened to sue California for checking up on him and said, leave me alone. After 4 years, he escaped the island. That was in November 1979. In violation of his parole, he disappeared forever. So he thought. He showed up in West Germany, where he was working for a municipal hospital, and a Woods magazine ran an article which showed the 10 most heinous crimes in world history. And it started out with Genghis Khan, and in there about number 8 was our friend, Dr. Peter David Plum. They recognized him right away as Dr. Arnold Schwarzenegger, the anesthesiologist on staff. They went to the chief surgeon and said, look at this picture. They went to his office, and the window was open, the curtains were blowing in the breeze, and the good doctor was gone. Sales New Yorker News ran an article in 1989, a little column called Whatever Happened To? And it said, whatever happened to Pisa David Plum? And the conclusion of the article was, they don't know what happened to him, and he couldn't be in the United States for all we know. However, since he was so good to come out here tonight, I'll tell you where he is. This is a correspondence between William Hoffman, who was Chief Assistant District Attorney in 1982, who writes to Dr. David Plani. It took him about 8 times to find out where he was, and the letters kept coming back. And the reason why he was writing to him was, is a district attorney, you have the obligation, if there's a death threat against the defendant, you have to notify that defendant to protect that person against being killed. And in fact, some nut called William Hoffman and told him, I'm really mad because justice was never served, and that jerk skipped out of parole, and I want to know where he is so I can go kill him myself. So Hoffman sends this letter, and it says, we're going to make money. Gentleman unknown to me, except that he gave his name, Charles, telephoned this office on November 9th, 1981, basically saying he wanted to kill me, or kill you. I tried to trace the call, but it was impossible, and I warned you because of the possibility that this guy might be telling the truth. My only suggestion is that you keep your eyes open, sincerely, William Hop. And, interestingly, returns the letter. He sent the letter from Baden, West Germany, which is where he is today, still alive at age 67. And it says, I edited out the return address because it contains his home number. It says, I appreciate very much your letter of warning. In order to assess the possible danger to my life, may I request your advising me of the following. One, how to interpret the elapsed 8 months between the letter threat and your advising letter of warning? 2, have there been new threats against my life? And 3, is my address known only to you, or must it be assumed that this is generally known in the U.S.? Thanking you once more for your concern, I remain yours sincerely, Pisa David Hoffman. In true form, Bill Hoffman returns his letter. It says, dear Dr. David Hoffman, this is a response to your letter of June 21st, 1992. To answer your question in order, 1, the time it took me to address a warning to you was occasioned by the fact that I simply could not locate you, nor could your California State parole officer. I did address a previous letter immediately after the threat to the address wherein the newspapers indicated you had been in Germany, but it was returned. You really should keep in touch with me. No renewed threats, just for one. 3, believe me, the time and trouble it took me to locate you cannot be duplicated by someone else. Unless you appear in the papers, I think your whereabouts will remain unknown. Sincerely, Bill Hoffman. And these letters came to my attention. They were in the files. And to my knowledge, they've never been published before. The next case is that of Zerker versus Stanford Daily, 1971. Very quickly, he stated.